progress at all, and you'll hit roadblocks that you don't know how to overcome, simply to be left flailing for what to even work on next. Trust me, keep it simple. If your first attempt at making a game turns out to be a one-room platformer with bad collision that you took 3 weeks to build, be proud of that, because you built it. You actually got it done. You made a game. That's more than most people ever manage. So play it, and show it to your friends. And don't worry when they don't understand it or are critical because they're still thinking in terms of the big budget games they're used to playing. You know how much work went into making that game, and more importantly, you know that next time you'll be able to do it even better and faster. Soon, you'll be building games that people are asking you to let them play. Second thing to keep in mind, and I know this is going to sound weird, but don't go into your first game with a specific idea. Learn what you can do and design around that. Don't lock yourself into an idea and beat your head against it for weeks or months. Instead, learn a few tricks, watch a few tutorials, then start looking towards something you're pretty sure you can build. It's okay if there are still a few parts of it you have no idea how to even start to do, but make sure it's only a few parts when you're breaking your projects down and planning things out. Which, of course, brings us to tutorials. Any major engine has tons of people who happily make tutorials about pretty much everything. Go find them, watch them, study them. Then, if you're stuck or if you can't find an answer to your question, just ask. You'd be shocked at how many people are happy to help you through things if you just post on a forum or throw your thoughts onto the message boards. And don't be afraid of coding. Lots of people say they can't code, but if you design your game right, you would be shocked at how little coding you actually have to do to get something done. It's a small enough amount that any of you out there watching this right now can handle it. Again, just start small, keep it simple. You'll learn as you go, and here especially, there are plenty of sites out there that'll help get you started. Stack Exchange is a fantastic place to look if you have questions. Which leads us nicely into one of the big ones. Design your game around your skills. Part of understanding your scope is understanding your resources, and in this case, you are your resources. Are you a great artist, but you've never coded in your life? In that case, have your game lean on your art skills while pushing you just enough on the code side that you learn some new things. Are you somebody who can't draw or model or animate? That's alright. There are plenty of games out there that get away with what you call minimal graphics. Except that you embrace it as part of your design. Constraints force us to be creative. And if there's something you really just have to have, if there's some coding task or some piece of art that your game just can't live without but you just don't have the chops to do it yourself, go to the asset store. There is an amazing amount of stuff that you can get there for next to nothing. James just talked to a professional studio that picked up their entire voice chat code from the asset store for less than it would have cost for all the other movies. James really wishes he had this sort of thing when he started out working in games, so take advantage of it. Finally, don't give up. There is a lot of life that's gonna get in the way. Most people start out doing this between juggling a job or a full school schedule, and it's very, very easy to let days and then weeks pass before you get back to working on your game. It's gonna be a struggle at first, no question. I wish I had more comforting words for you, but all I can say is that most things worth doing are a struggle. And if you stick with it, maybe one day you'll have the option to make games instead of having to do all the other stuff. But that's it for the basics. I know that was all broad, basic stuff that most of you probably already knew, but I think it's important to start there, because when you're deep in the process of making a game, it's often that really high-level, basic stuff that's good for you.
No, I didn't take out my zombie.
No, you made this out.
Yeah, I know, I'm pissed. I was kicked off because the dog didn't punch me. Stupid dog! Deal with- Oh my god, that's not a good one.
Cardboard
at work. No, that was so stupid. Oh my god, there's like a horde of stuff coming at me. He was
Every week, we are asked the question, what skills do I need to be a game designer? This is an incredibly complicated question, one that James has had to wrestle with both vocationally and pedagogically.
What the heck?
This work. But this week, we're going to try and give you the best answer we've been able to
come up with.
So, what should you learn if you want to be a game designer?
You're ready? Never.
Seriously, game design is the art of crafting experiences, and you'll find yourself drawing on everything you know. A great game designer, there is no useless knowledge. But not all of us have the time to learn everything that ever was or will be before starting to design experiences, so what should you focus on? Well, first, you can start with a game designer's single most core skill, communication. As you start to build games, most of you will find that you have to work with interdisciplinary teams, teams formed of people with radically different skill sets and backgrounds from you. If you work on video games, you'll have to work with artists, programmers, designers, producers, sound guys, marketers, and business people. If you can't communicate the experience you're trying to design to each of these groups, the quality of your ideas will not matter because these are the people that translate those ideas into an experience that reaches the world. The the tricky part here is how different all these people are. I know it's a horrible generalization, but I'm going to say it anyway. Artists and programmers have a totally opposite, diametrically opposed way of approaching problems. And it's your job to make both of those people share the same vision. Which brings us to our next point, and this is extremely important. The game designer is not the same as a director. Your job is not to be a dictator, demanding people to implement your brilliant ideas. Everyone who touches a game influences its design, even if you don't intend for them to. When your programmer writes a physics system, the choices he makes are going to impact the design of the game. Anyone out there who thinks that the designer is the guy who gets to decide what the game is has some serious disillusionment ahead of them before they can excel at this job. Speaking of common misconceptions, here's another important tip. Game design is not the job of creating fabulous stories or coming up with concepts for games. Concepts are cheap. Every one of you budding designers probably have 5 or 6 you can pull out right now. Even if you don't want to get into game design, probably come up with 1 or 2 game ideas over the years. Hell, I'd be a terrible game designer, but even I can come up with 2 or 3. Not only are game concepts cheap, but they're also pretty meaningless. At the end of the day, the best-selling franchise of all time is about an Italian stereotype and hallucinogens. One of the most lauded concepts of the last few years was first-person shooter Ayn Rand Underwater. Go. Real game design is a lot of hard, rote work, creating systems, mechanics, levels. Concepts are great, but if that's what you want to do, you probably better find another field. And this isn't any room in the game studio for a specialized idea guy. Every game studio is full of idea guys, and everyone who works there has ideas, good ones. What studios are looking for are people who can make those concepts a reality. Another important thing that every game designer has to learn eventually is that you are the worst judge of your own games. Especially early on, when you can justify away the flaws, it's easy to fall into the trap of saying that people just don't get it because they haven't seen the finished product. This is almost never true. Introspection and the ability to take criticism are core designer skills. Don't let yourself get too attached to your ideas, because you'll always be wrong. No great game has ever, ever sprung fully formed from a game designer's head. Games need players. Players themselves design half the experience that they play. Being able to accept that your idea didn't work, to be willing to give up on that idea you loved so much because it just isn't working, and try something else, these are the hallmarks of a great game designer. Next, game design is a discipline. Just because you've played a lot of games, or a whole lot of a specific game, does not mean you're prepared to design games. Most of the time, designers don't play games. They study them and analyze them. They deconstruct their systems and test all their breakpoints. A designer will figure out where all the triggers are located, and then try to figure out why. They'll reverse engineer the math behind the principal systems. Designers are as fascinated by what makes an experience unfun as by what makes it fun. Additionally, a game designer must understand the cost of the decisions they make. Whenever you make a decision as a designer, what you're really doing is asking people to do work. That work represents time and money, and you have a finite amount of work that will ever be done on your project. Your job as a designer is to ensure the most bang for your buck. I know this may not seem like that big a deal, but trust me, this is the number one cause of failed games. From the giants of the AAA industry to the small fry of hobbyist modders, more game projects fail because of teams with a poor sense of scope than any other reason. As a corollary to that point, understand that no game is ever done. Ever. During the process of putting your game together, I guarantee you'll find things you should have done differently, and discover countless other amazing things you could do. File those ideas away, or at least realize how incredibly expensive it usually is to expand the scope of your game history. Remember, at some point, you must ship. You can't work on your game first, and you haven't made a game unless people are playing it. On top of all that stuff, here's a list of the main practical skills you'll need if you want
to
be a
game designer. Let's go into your working computer,
right?
All right, Jacob, let's... Devontae.
You're getting on track, right?
Get to work,
Jacob. Like, get to work, Jacob.
Truth is, I just slack around too much, right?
Yeah.
All right, Devontae, let's start working now.
So how you guys put together the string of all the photos that were currently...